If a photo is worth 1,000 words, how many would a map be worth? A few thousand? A million? We as visual but also spatial creatures connect this way to the space around us. Somehow, neatly designed graphics find their way into our brain, and all of a sudden, we clearly understand space and all the spatial relationships. I'm not sure who said it first, but understanding precedes taking action. Meaning, having a beautifully designed map allows us to understand what kind of analysis we might need, or what type of information we already have or need to get. Nowadays, all this ideally falls under the domain of GIS. Just like the field of geography, GIS is very, very hard to define. Go ahead, ask 5 different users and you will likely get 5 different answers, to say at least. GIS is the hardware, the software, the procedures used to facilitate the manipulation and management of the data, the modeling and analyzing. GIS is basically the complex problem solving. According to ESRI, a geographic information system is a system that creates, manages, analyzes, and maps all types of data. This means connecting where things are with what things are like there. Yep. This means incorporating geographical features with tabular data in order to analyze and assess real-world problems and challenges. Right, this sounds great, but what is the power of GIS? Do I even need a GIS? Well, does anyone? The truth is, if you do work with large amounts of data and you need them somehow visualized and analyzed, you might not need a GIS, but you most certainly will need answers. We all want some tool that facilitates our struggles, don't we? Location is a pretty powerful element of your data because we obviously know the what and when. And probably know the how. But do we really, like for real, understand the where? Just for the record, and to give you an example, researchers have used GIS to identify how to target immunization campaigns in geographically isolated locations. Which leads me to the interesting story of how GIS evolved and the history behind it. Imagine now, the first example of linking the what with the where takes us back to the cholera outbreak in 1854. At the time, people believed that the disease was being spread through the air, and one man named John Snow wasn't quite convinced this was the case. He decided to map the outbreak locations, began mapping the roads, the property boundaries, and the water lines. And having done all this, he made a discovery. One simple yet very important one. A pattern. This pattern proved that the disease was not in fact airborne, but instead was being communicated by water. So this so-called cholera map was one major event in linking the what with the where. And this was also the beginning of spatial analysis, demonstrating how GIS is a problem-solving tool. However, the birth of the modern GIS wasn't until the 1960s. In the time period between 1960s to the mid-70s was when the real pioneers in GIS emerged, like Roger Thomlinson, Type Anywhere, the father of GIS. This was all because computer hardware and software development spurred at that time, which led to general purpose computer mapping applications developing. Well, I don't want no digital map. I'm very used to my old traditional table maps. Why do you always have to change everything? This kind of visual representation of data is dynamic and interactive. Imagine what you could do. You could reveal previously unseen features, highlight them, or show the changes of those features over time, or just read the attributes. Wait, attributes? Yep, if you thought GIS is vague, oh, you haven't seen anything yet. Just wait till you find out all the details about the types of data and datasets being used. As engineers like to split or categorize things, it sure makes life easier. And in this case, into three main categories: spatial data, attribute, and metadata. Or vector data, raster, topology, attribute, and data about data.